good morning. Wow, it's good to see you all spread out. Wow, these are different times that we're living in, isn't it? But you know what? God didn't wake up shocked. God is not surprised, and my God is a good God. And, you know, that is the message. I bring greetings from my family, those who aren't here, Rachel and Caleb, some of my contingents here. But it's good to be here. We're driving in, and Brianna says, it's like we're coming home. So, hallelujah. Yeah, there's a lot that I'd like to share, and I think this ends at 12, right? I realized I came up wrong, actually. I think I sat there, I was supposed to follow the arrows, and I hope that's okay. So right now, I live in Castle Comer. I work in Kilkenny for the Lighthouse Community Center, or whatever it's called, as coordinator for a project that's primarily devoted to youth, but is trying to work together with all the churches in the community. And we're redeveloping that vision to not just incorporate youth, but a lot of what I do is online. And Noel knows that I used to be stay away from online as much as I could, and my whole job is pretty much online now, and learning how that works and how to communicate. So I work for them part-time, we have a ministry that we started years ago called Grassroots Church Planting Ministries. I do a bit online. I do Facebook Live. Some of you have seen those and been involved those. And for years, I had a vision to desire to create a discipleship school. I always wanted, that was just always something that was there. And about 6-7 months ago, the Lord said, okay, it's time, but I want you to do it online. So I've been working on a curriculum. I've been writing. I haven't written in years. I've written books, but I haven't written in years, and I'm in the process of like writing six or seven books that would go with this, and hopefully going to bring it online and do mixed social media and all that. So I'm figuring out how that all works and learning. But God is at work. The church is still growing, and I think one of the things that I felt is that there's a desire, and I understand that, and I think there's some truth, this desire to go back to the way things were, but God is also doing a new thing, and at the same time, while we look towards how do we connect to what was, what is God doing now? There's some different things that are happening and going to happen through the process of this, and God wants to reveal those things to his people and speak to us. I believe that the way things were got us to part of the problem of why things are going on the way they are now. So to go back to the way things were isn't enough. And one of those things that I feel that God is speaking, he's been stirring in my heart, my family's heart, probably about particularly the past year and a half that he's been working on us, and I'll just say it with this statement, and I'll kind of maybe go back to it at different times, is that you can have as much of God as you want. You can have as much of God as you want. So often we've been waiting on God. But actually, all of the Godhead is available to us right now. We've already got it. It's already finished. And so, you know, praying for revival, God, please come. Come and pour out your spirit. Come and do something new is wrong. Well, that just threw a bunch of... Because God's already done it all. And so much, and I'm learning this, I'm studying this, I'm learning this, so much of what the church has been praying for actually has been unbelief. But faith takes work. Now listen, it's all been done for us by grace. I preached grace strong, I preach grace strong, stronger. It's already been accomplished. But faith is not us getting God to do something for us. We don't need to pray and beg God to pour out his spirit. He already gave his spirit 2,000 years ago. We just need to believe it and receive it. But to build faith takes work. And I really want to, I actually told Noah, I said I got two different messages for both of the services, but both of them have one link in them both. I'm going to talk about the Holy Spirit. I'm going to talk about the Holy Spirit. And you know, my kids have been great. Actually, I brought some cards. I just I just printed these up recently. I love praying, and I love praying the word. So don't get me wrong. It's not about not praying. I love praying. I do a lot of praying. And I print these up. I brought some if people want. And the Lord gave me this for my kids. And one side is for my daughter, and one side is for my son. I just read it to you. But they're all based on scripture. And again, I brought some. I don't know where we could maybe put them. People could grab them. My son is taught of the Lord, and great shall be his peace. I'll pick on Benjamin since he's here. I put his name. Benjamin is a mighty oak of righteousness, the planting of the Lord. He is like a tree planted before streams of water. He brings forth fruit in his season. Whatever he does, he prospers. He takes his mountains in life. He guards his heart with all diligence. He seeks first the kingdom of God. He knows his God and does great exploits. He has favor with God and man. He's a godly husband, marries a virtuous woman. His quiver is blessed and full. Goodness and mercy shall follow him all the days of his life, and he will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. This is what I pray over my kids. And I tell you what, you know, it's been an adjustment. As we have made adjustments in our family over the past year and a half and changes, there's been things we recognize that it's a choice. God, there's a choice in love. Sometimes we're waiting on God, or we're looking for a feeling. That's one of the problems with Pentecostalism or non-denominationalism or whatever it is that we call ourselves, is that we're often waiting for an experience. We're looking for the experience. But actually, the experience has already been given to us. And by faith, we obtain those things. And so we've made some choices in our family. There's been some changes. And our kids were kind of like, I remember we first started, they were like, I don't know if I like the new dad. You know? Oh, we're not watching this week. Well, we're not watching this week. We're going to just spend time in the Word and some time in some prayer. You know, but my kids have, I'm so proud of them, so I brag on them. They're rising up, and they're growing in their walk with God and their understanding of God. Benjamin was at a friend's house last night at a sleepover. I hope they social distanced. And but they're he calls me up, Dad, they're watching a movie. They're about to watch a movie that I don't agree with. And I said, you know, don't watch it. Go to the parent. And the parents are like, no, I think this is okay. He's like, no, this is not okay. So the dad looked it up. He's like, no, this isn't okay, you know. And I just like, you know, that's God in them, you know. And I remember earlier in the beginning of this year, God really started to take me at a deeper level in this journey. And again, this is not about me. Just hope you hear this. It's not about, oh, look what you did or what your kids are doing. It's about God. But it's about the pursuit of God, you know. And so in the beginning of the year, Rachel and myself, towards the end of last year, we started fasting more. And I've always believed in fasting, and I've done some fasting. But the Lord started speaking to us. So we started fasting more. And I feel I'm supposed to fast 7 days in January. And she said, dude, you're so skinny. So I started to fast. And in the middle of it, God said, I want you to fast the entire month of February. And so I went to my wife and said, I meant to fast February too. And she's just like, man. And she did most of it with me. And I did 14 days of water. And the rest of the time I did juicing. So I didn't eat anything solid for 36 days. And it was like God was... And there was a lot of grace on that. I can't just like, okay, I'm going to do that again right now. And she was like, you're going to die. You're going to disappear, you know. And I was like, I have to do this. But what I realized is that we get God what we put in. You know, it's I know this can sound weird, but it's like a bit of a chess match with God, or chess game with God. God says, I've died. I've given my son. I've sent the Holy Spirit. Your move. And then the great thing about God is as soon as we make a move, then he comes and meets us right in that place. But it's a relationship. It's a relationship. So I want to look at a few scriptures, and we're just going to see. John chapter 16, I want to look at a few passages, just read a few passages together before I share anything. John chapter 16. Jesus is talking about the Holy Spirit here. John chapter 16, verse 5. on a device. You got there quicker than the rest of us. It says, but now I go away to him who sent me, and none of you asks, where are you going? But because I have said these things, sorrow has filled your heart. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is to your advantage that I go away. For if I do not go away, the Helper will not come to you. But if I depart, I will send him to you. And when he has come, he will convict the world of sin and of righteousness and judgment. Of sin because they do not believe in me. Of righteousness because I go to my Father. And you will see me no more. Of judgment because of the ruler of this world has been judged. I still have many things to say to you, but you cannot bear them right now. However, when he, the Spirit of truth, has come, he will guide you into all truth. For he will not speak of his own authority, but whatever he hears, he will speak, and he will tell you things to come. He will glorify me, for he will take of what is mine and declare it to you. All things that the Father has are mine. Therefore, I said to you that he will take of mine and declare it to you. If you want to turn to 1 John. 1 John chapter 2. First John chapter 2, verse 24. I'll give you a second. Therefore, let that abide in you which you heard from the beginning. If what you heard from the beginning abides in you, you will also abide in the Son and in the Father. And this is the promise that he has promised us, eternal life. These things I have written to you concerning those who try to deceive you. But the anointing which you have received from him abides in you, and you do not need that anyone teach you. But as the same anointing teaches you concerning all things, and it is true, and it is not a lie, and just as it is taught you, you will abide in him. Okay, I want to read one other scripture here. Mark chapter 7, and then I'm going to go back to the John passage in John chapter 16. Mark chapter 7. Verse 1. Then the Pharisees and some of the scribes came together to him, having come from Jerusalem. Now when they saw some of his disciples eat bread with defiled, that is, with unwashed hands, they found fault. For the Pharisees and all the Jews do not eat unless they wash their hands in a special way, holding the tradition of the elders. When they come from the marketplace, they do not eat unless they wash. And there are many things which they have received and hold, like the washing of cups, pitchers, copper vessels, and couches. Then the Pharisees and scribes asked him, "Why do your disciples not walk according to the tradition of the elders, but eat bread with unwashed hands?" He answered and said to them, "Well did Isaiah prophesy of you hypocrites, as it is written, 'This people honors me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. And in vain they worship me, teaching as doctrine the commandments of men. For laying aside the commandment of God, you hold the tradition of men, the washing of pitchers and cups, and many such other things as you do.' He said to them, 'All too well you reject the commandment of God, that you may keep your tradition.'" Then down to verse 12. "Then you no longer do anything." Down to verse 13, because he explains something. "Making the word of God of no effect through your tradition, which you have handed down, and many such other things." All right, I'm going to go back to John chapter 16, if you want to go back there, as I kind of work through some things. Jesus describes what's going to happen. Now, it's interesting I think it's important that we understand Scripture and look at Scripture and let it interpret itself and let it speak to us. So Jesus says, "I'm going to send the Holy Spirit to you, and he's going to reveal to you all truth." Okay? He desires that the truth that is in us. And James, the book of James, James talks about that when you become, and I forget, I think it's in Colossians as well, they talk about when you come to salvation, you actually receive the Spirit of truth. Okay? So within salvation, in the package of salvation, comes the Spirit of truth. Jesus said, "I'm going to send the Holy Spirit." And he said, the Holy Spirit is going to reveal to you the things that I teach you. The Holy Spirit is going to reveal Jesus to us. Okay? So this is really important that you understand this. The Holy Spirit comes to reveal truth. Comes to reveal truth. Truth is Jesus. Jesus said, I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life. John chapter 1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word became flesh. You can't know, some people say, well, I pray. I love to pray. I read the Bible some, and I pray a lot. But what I have realized is that actually Jesus is the Word. You can't know Jesus unless you know the Word. Jesus is the Word. It's who he is. And it's who the Holy Spirit came to reveal. And so the Word is really important. Now, I understand that there's places and cultures where they don't have access to the Word of God. Okay? But I'm not talking to that culture. Okay? I'm talking to a culture that has access. That has access to that. And there's power in the Word. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. We're talking about accessing the things of God and the Spirit through faith. If we have little word, then guess where your faith level's at? Okay? We're following the progression. Now, Jesus says later in this, the disciples say, he says, I'm going to the Father. Show us the Father. Okay? Now, Jesus said, if you have seen me, you have seen the Father. So the Holy Spirit comes and is here. Jesus isn't here. Where's Jesus? I'm testing your theology. Where's Jesus? He's at the right hand of the Father. So Jesus isn't here. Now, he does appear to people, and that happens now, but Jesus isn't here on the earth walking around. He's at the right hand of the Father, Ephesians chapter 1. So the Holy Spirit is here with us and in us to reveal truth and to reveal Jesus. Jesus says, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. In fact, there's another scripture, and I can't remember where it's at right now referencing, but it comes to my mind, where it says, actually, I think it's in Corinthians, that you will not understand the Old Testament unless you understand Jesus. That's why somebody says, well, the Jews follow God. It's not enough, because Jesus even reveals the Old Testament. A lot of the Old Testament is about Jesus. Jesus came to reveal the Father. So if you think, now, this is the part of covenants, old covenant, new covenant, and understanding. But if you think that the Father, and here's a whole, I don't have time to get into this, but so often we have a problem with the Father, and we look to the Old Testament, and that's our understanding of the Father. But Jesus said, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. How I behave is what he's like. Now, this is important, because a lot of the message of the church is, if you don't accept Jesus, you're going to hell. Now, Jesus talked about hell, but the message of Jesus was Acts 10:38. Jesus went about doing good, healing all who were oppressed by the devil. Well, that just throws out, well, you know what, I'm sick, to learn more about God. Well, that just throws that out, because Jesus isn't capable of doing that, because he came about to do good and to heal all who are oppressed by the devil. So we've got the Father is loving. Jesus is the Father manifest to us, and also has paid the price that we could be in relationship, and through him made way for the Holy Spirit to come into us if we receive it by faith and walk in relationship with him. So therefore we can walk in the same way that Jesus walked, as co-heirs with him. Man, this stuff's awesome. It's awesome. Come on. You know, I'm just like, Lord, teach me this stuff, because I haven't lived it. I've lived a little bit of it. And the church has taken the message of the gifts, and we're going to hit this towards the end of the message, taken the message of the gifts and distorted it in a way that people think, well, they've got this gift and they've got this gift, and that's not, God didn't give this to me, and they've got this anointing. And we understand that there's a variety that exists in the body of Christ, and God's given different gifts that some people more, but a lot of the gifts are for all of us. And I'm going to get to that at the end of the message. And it's actually interesting. It talks about in Corinthians about the gift, and it says to each of you, a lot of translations say a measure of faith, but actually in the original language, there's debate by scholars, but it really appears, and I believe so, says the measure of faith. See, we've all been given the measure of faith. And then how much do we operate in that is to the degree that we access that faith. To the degree that we access that faith. Because they were fighting and the Corinthian church was like, oh, I'm better at this, or you have this, or they're disagreeing. And he's saying, listen, we've all received the same measure of faith from God, but it's going to operate in different ways. Operate in the measure that you've been given, grow in it, access it. You've got it all in Christ. And so Jesus is talking about here, he says the Holy Spirit is going to come. Now there's a couple of things I want to just talk about this, and then I want to pray and give opportunity for maybe those of you. I'll set you up. If you don't speak in tongues, that's where we're going eventually with this message. And we're going to have opportunity for you to do that here. Okay? So if that's in your heart and you feel something, you know, here burning. Actually, it's funny. In Western terms, we talk about our heart. But actually, where's the Holy Spirit? I notice that, man. I get praying in tongues of the Spirit speak to me, feel it in my belly. Jesus said, he who believes in me, they come to me and are thirsty. Out of their belly will flow rivers of living water. Where's the Spirit? Man, it's at work inside of there. So right now, maybe somebody's like, man, I feel a stirring in my belly. That's because I just called your number. Holy Spirit is like, man, I want to flow out of you. And for some of you, maybe this is your opportunity to step into something new and what the Holy Spirit has for you if you've not experienced it before. Amen? And for us to all grow in it. Hallelujah. Okay, all right, just, you know. So, really important. One of the things that stops the flow of God's Spirit working within you. Now, again, we in these passages we looked at, one of the key elements of what the Holy Spirit is going to do is bring us into all truth. Okay? Okay? There's power released through the Holy Spirit. But the Holy Spirit's ministry is to lead us into truth. What is the quickest thing to dampen the truth revealed by the Holy Spirit? We looked at a passage in Mark chapter 7, and I just recently have been seeing the traditions of men. Oh, nothing dampens the move of the Holy Spirit quicker than the religious mindset, religion. It just cuts it short. It just makes it inactive and powerless. It just doesn't give him the freedom to flow in our lives. And that's why there is so much division over the Holy Spirit. Why there's so much division over the message of love and grace. Because it frees you to be in relationship with the Father and the fullness of the Holy Spirit at work within you, flowing through you. And the enemy knows this. And people throughout since I've been alive, the 46 years I've been alive, though I probably don't remember much when I was real little, but since I've been alive and I've read history, the controversy where people would say, but if it was God, it wouldn't create division in the church. Religion creates division in the church. Now, I'm not here to say that every manifestation, every expression that has happened in the name of the Holy Spirit is valid or not of the flesh. I'm not here to have that discussion or analyze it. And I would agree to say, yes, the flesh has gotten in there when the Holy Spirit moves. But the answer sometimes is shut down the Holy Spirit so that we get rid of the flesh. You know, it's not the answer. It's not the answer for the world. I quoted already, Acts 10:38. Jesus went about doing good, healing all who were sick and oppressed by the devil. There's so many things going on in the world today, and I'm convinced that actually the answer for the lost and for the world is not to get the government saved or be of a particular political persuasion or try to convince people that they're a sinner, but it's to have the revelation of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit at work in your life and in the church. And when that happens, the sick are healed, the dead are raised, the demons are cast out. They were added to the church daily. This is the life that God has called us to live. But we can't obtain it when we have a divided heart. Because when you're of two minds, two souls, when you're seeking God and seeking the world, it makes it inactive or less than, or it takes away from, makes us unstable. And when I look at the church and when I see certain areas of my life, certain areas God has done a tremendous work and I hold on to steadfastly, but there are other areas of my life where I see that I'm tossed to and fro. That's double-mindedness. And the Holy Spirit wants to reveal to us truth about who Jesus is in us, work through his power and show us the Father so that we can have that fullness at work within us. And so the traditions, so Jesus said, the Holy Spirit will guide you. Now, I'm not suggesting that we don't need church, because I believe in church. I'm not suggesting that we don't need fellowship. But what I'm suggesting to you is that often we've allowed the traditions of men, the teachings of men, maybe the sermon. Listen, it doesn't matter what I preach if you don't get hold of it in your life what the Word of God says to you. And if what you should be checking what I'm saying, is it in the Word of God? There should be something where we're going to God and say, the Holy Spirit is in you. There are times as I was in my early 20s, particularly, I remember being in meetings and sensing something that I was seeing and experiencing, not being of God, or that there was some different revelation. But I threw it to the side because I thought, oh, well, everybody else is experiencing God like this, or everybody else, something is happening. And I've denied the Holy Spirit speaking and growing to me where I'm at. Listen, don't cut off the work of the Holy Spirit within you. We have to trust that he leads us and guides us. Now, I'm thankful for accountability and people in my life that have helped me maneuver to be able to hear the Holy Spirit better. But here's the thing. You can't have, community's important, but your greatest intimacy has got to be with God. And there's so much fear in the church because we don't know God. Hebrews chapter 6 says that Jesus destroyed the works of the devil and took away the fear of death. Every fear in your life that pops up, or in my life that pops up, is centered on one fear alone, the fear of death. I never saw that before, but it's true. But those who have no fear of death do what? Hebrews says, come boldly before the throne of grace in time of need. What does boldly come look like? Oh God, please come and pour out your spirit. No. I tell you what boldness, you understand boldness when you're a parent. You understand boldness when you're a parent. You know? My kids, when they're this big, you know, I'm bigger than they are. You know? I mean, think about this. You're in school. And if you're like this big and a bully is this big, you know, you usually watch what, you know, I'm going to avoid them, you know. I'm going to avoid them. Anybody ever been bullied before? You know, I'm going to avoid them. I'm going to stay away from them. I'm bigger. My kids are this big. Dad, give me food now. Well, I'm doing something right now. Dad, I'm hungry. Give me money. I want to do this. I said you can't. Now we teach our kids not to do that. It just takes a little process sometimes. Now I'm not suggesting we do that with God, but that's the context when he says, comes boldly before me in the throne of grace in time of need. Man, I was at a prayer meeting not long ago, and the prayer was, oh God, we come to you in our feeble faith. I just thought, oh Lord, I hope he doesn't answer that one. He probably won't. Because it's not scriptural. You don't come before God in your feeble, you know, but I used to do this. Oh God, weak and struggling I am. Man, we used to sing songs. Oh Lord, it's my confession that I'm so weak. Man, now I'm like, I ain't singing that song anymore. You know what? You don't have to diminish yourself in order to make God greater, and that is a fallacy. Let me just side note, that's a fallacy in the church. I am just getting that. Man, that's just so, you don't, to make God greater. You see, God is amazing, and you don't have to make yourself the pond scum on the bottom of the foot of the snail at the bottom of the swamp in order for God to be magnified. And neither does he want you to. And so you don't need to come to God, oh, we're wretched worms that we are. Oh, we humble ourselves before you. We beseech thee. We're just these terrible little sinners. You know, God, 2 Chronicles 7:14 says if we humble ourselves, so let's just make sure we sit around and pray and say that we're terrible wretches and horrible, wicked people. That's not what God is saying to do. That's not the heart intent of the scripture. If my kids came up to me and said, oh, Dad, would you feed me? I know I don't deserve it. I didn't do everything you asked me to do today, but I'm hungry. Please give me food. Please feed me. I beg of you. Oh, I'm just a wretch, but hey, I'm thankful that you love. I'd just be like, would you get off of me and get up and sit down and eat? I would feel as a failure as a parent if my kids responded to that way. And I bet God feels in the sense of that's a failure as a parent on God's part if that's the way we have to come to him. Because if me as an earthly father are wicked, and he is so much better, if I did that to my kids and made them do that, you know what? Child services would be at my house. And yet we have believed and taught that God is like that. It's no wonder people don't want to come to church. It's no wonder that unless people feel absolutely desperate, sometimes they crawl in and then they're met with these religious rules that are all thrown upon them to make them feel worse and worse and worse. And some of them stick it through just because they have a heart for God, and other ones leave because we painted this picture of God, the Father, that makes people like, oh. And young people go, man, the entertainment industry is just way too cool for me to spend my time groveling on a carpet saying, God, I'm unworthy. Please come. Oh, please. Hopefully he'll come. So let's go back to John chapter 6. I want to read you something here to hopefully spark that relationship. And then I want to talk about the Holy Spirit. It says in verse 8 of chapter 16. And when he has come, he will convict the world of sin and of righteousness and of judgment. When I used to read this, I don't know if it was just me being casual and reading it, or if it was the way it was taught to me, or was a combination of the two, but I used to think, okay, that's what the Holy Spirit does. Holy Spirit, what is the work of the Holy Spirit in my life? He convicts me of sin, of righteousness and judgment. Well, I don't know if I quite understand all that means, but that's what he does. Actually, he doesn't. Read the next verse. It will explain, okay? The next verse explains. Of sin, because they do not believe in me. Okay, this is a really key point that I want to make, and we're going to go through these, and this is really key in setting us up, because the Holy Spirit comes to reveal what? Truth. What often stands in the way of truth? The traditions of men and religion. Are you hearing it? You seeing how this message is coming together? It actually is. And actually, these texts are coming together. What's an opposite of truth is religion. And God says, I desire truth in the inner parts. He said to the woman at the well, the true worshipers will worship in spirit and in truth. Truth is pretty important. You shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. So what does that mean about the opposite? You live in lies, you'll be in bondage. Jesus said that I come to give life and give it more abundantly. If we're not, every area of our life that we're not living in abundance, we're living in lies. Okay? And so he comes to reveal truth. And so religion stands the way. So he says, of sin. So there's this idea that the Holy Spirit goes around to convict you of sin. How many here, okay, I'll ask you, you'll have to be bold, you can be honest. How many here, I love it when people are honest, I'd rather have people honest than lie. How many people here are Christians? If you're not, you don't have to raise your hand, that's okay. That's okay. Okay. Now, what does it say here? It says, of sin because they do not believe in me. Who's he talking about? He's talking about the unbelievers. Okay? The Holy Spirit is at work on the earth to convict the unbeliever of sin, not the church. Now let that sink in, and all religion fight against it. He did not come, he doesn't convict you of sin. He comes to convict the world of sin. Okay, what does it say? Then what does he say next? Of righteousness, because I go to my Father and, what does it say? You see me no more. Who's he talking about now? He's talking to his disciples. And if you're his disciple, he's talking to you and to me. So what does he come to, Holy Spirit, to come to convict you of? Righteousness. Now watch, Scripture interprets Scripture. James chapter, I think it's chapter 1 or chapter 2 says, talks about that when, don't be the person who looks in the mirror and forgets about what they see and walk away. Now I used to think, oh yeah, so it says be a doer. And it says in that context, it wasn't until a couple of years ago, I was really meditating on it, I go, oh, he says, don't forget that when you walk away from that mirror, he says the law of liberty. So what does that mean? It means that the Holy Spirit, to the unbeliever, he says, you need to repent because you're living in sin. You need a Savior. To the believer, he doesn't say, you need to repent. You're a sinner. Now, we do believe in repentance as Christians because repentance, for the Christians, see, repentance has different words in the original Greek. The repentance for Christians means the renewing of the mind, to think differently, okay? The repentance for the sinner who's unsaved is about salvation, okay? So there is a repentance that, so this is actually probably would be describing that repentance. So to the righteous, he says, hey, you shouldn't be doing that because that's not who you are. You're struggling with alcoholism. That's not who you are. You're the righteousness of Christ. You know, I'm thankful for groups like AA and the way they've helped people, but at the same time, there's a part of it I don't like. I don't like people sitting around in a chair for the rest of their life saying, my name is so-and-so and I'm an alcoholic. Because the proper response once you're a Christian is, my name is James and I'm the righteousness of Christ. The Holy Spirit comes to bring revelation of who you are in Jesus because the Holy Spirit comes to reveal truth and his truth is he reveals Jesus, okay? So it's imagine that, it all links together. And he says, don't walk away from the mirror and forget who you are. James is a book about works, but not in the way that it's taught a lot of times. It's actually a book on faith. James is a book on faith. He says, if you don't have any works, odds are you don't have any faith. You got to read the whole book through and through to understand what he's saying. So James is a book on faith, and he's challenging you saying, because people were saying, I am a Christian, and it doesn't matter how I live. And he says, well, show me your faith by your works. If you don't have works, you probably don't have faith. So the answer is, the church often the answer has been, you better do better works. The answer in the Bible is, you better know who you are in Christ. Because the change is from the inside out, not from the outside in. See, religion is from the outside in. Hoping. And the Christianity, I'll be honest, the Christianity sometimes that's preached is actually no different than being Muslim, except for it's got Jesus in it. No different than being a Jehovah's Witness, no different than being any other religion that talks about, I get to God because I do good works. We say you're saved by grace and through Jesus by faith, but then we have to be careful because suddenly, as Paul says in the book of Galatians, then suddenly you've saved by grace, but you live by grace. And if we change our message, then we're no different than any other religion which says, I can get to God according to my behavior, which nullifies the cross. Which means we spit on Jesus' face and say, I don't need what you did. See, people think the grace message takes away from the cross. But if you don't preach the grace message, you actually deny the cross. Jesus said, there's only one door, and anybody who comes over the wall is a thief and a robber. You can't get to Jesus any other way. Let me tell you what, you can't live for Jesus any other way. Okay? What's the last part that he says in this verse? And then I would just want to talk about the Holy Spirit here and give us a little time. Of judgment, because of the ruler of this world is judged. Who's judged in the passage? The ruler of the world. Guess what that means? He's underneath my feet. Now that's a revelation. I'm just like, Lord, I've just been reading and studying about spiritual authority. It's one of the books I'm working on. And I'm just like, wow, God has given us so much. I was on social media and somebody had this picture of the tension of the battle they were feeling. It had Satan and Jesus arm wrestling. And the artist had made like this, the world looked like this table. So it looked like they were, and I was just like, that is wrong. Jesus is not arm wrestling with the devil. But how often do we treat like that? How often do our prayers like that? Oh, the devil. Oh, the devil. You know, we give the devil a lot of credit. Actually, we empower the devil a lot through our words. Sometimes I talk to Christians, and I know more what the devil's doing than what God's doing. Oh, you know what's going on in the world, and this is going on in my family, and I've got these fears, and I so valued, you know, it's just like, you know, we need to be honest about what we feel. Man, that was stupid preaching. We're not called to just be this hidden fake people, but at the same time, your feelings often are against the truth. So if you're just going to talk about how you feel, probably you're just going to talk about what the devil's doing. Well, my kids aren't listening to me, and my husband or my wife, they just, you know, they're not paying attention to my needs, and I feel, you know, this and that. You know, okay, what's God doing in your life? Our confession should be the word, and if you read the prayers of people that are recorded in Scripture, often they prayed the solution instead of the problem. And you wonder why your prayers aren't being answered. And you just think, well, maybe God doesn't want to answer this, or you know, maybe I need to try harder. But you know what? I realize maybe we're praying wrong. And so God wants to teach us how to pray in that. And so the ruler, so sin, the Holy Spirit convicts the world of sin. He can convict you that you're righteous. And he convicted and judged the devil. Revelation tells us the story, gives us a picture, goes back in time. I think it's in chapter 9, talks about the woman and the dragon. And it says in there, and the woman, Jesus, this is about Jesus coming forth. It's like a picture of a history lesson that he gives us in the middle of the book of Revelation. And it says, at that time, Satan was thrown out of heaven. And he's running on the world because he knows that his time is short. For 2,000 years, he was thrown out of heaven. You know, you read about in the book of Job, you read about how, like, the devil was there reasoning with God over Job. I'm not going to get into that book right now. But actually, he's not there anymore. He's been kicked out. He's running around here, frantic, because he knows his time is short. And he's been put underneath our feet. Psalm 91, Luke 11, 19. I've given you power to crush the heads of serpents. And so God wants us to have that revelation that because of the Holy Spirit, the same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead, Ephesians 1, is inside of us. It's inside of us. We're seated with Christ in heavenly places. And so the devil has been judged. And he's been sent out of heaven onto the earth. And he's underneath our feet. And the Holy Spirit, that's been a finished work. And that's what we need to get, that it's a finished work. And the Holy Spirit reveals that to us. Okay, Holy Spirit, I want to just give us an opportunity in just finishing up. And I would encourage you, just study this stuff, man. It's just awesome. The Word of God is awesome. You know, so often I've found that the difficult passages that I have found difficult, or the difficult passages that people have shared with me, often are us taking something and isolating it and making a doctrine around it. But I remember about 4 years ago, 2016, the Lord told me to start at the beginning and read the Bible. And I did it about 3 or 4 times, and now I'm kind of more just reading in passages. But man, you get perspective of the heart and the plan of God when you see it throughout the ages. And Scripture is progressive. There's a progressiveness to Scripture, progressiveness to the revelation that is really important that we hear and we understand. And God, and we're living in such an amazing time. We're living in such an amazing time. What I want to do is give opportunity to if you never been baptized in the Holy Spirit. The Bible talks about salvation, and it talks about the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And there's a very distinct experiences within that. But I want to particularly focus on the gift of tongues. And the reason why I want to do this is because there's something that is released when we pray in tongues. And I suppose this is fresh in my life because the Lord has been speaking to me about this. And I've been trying to, me and my wife have been trying to practice this where we just say, okay, what does it look like if we take an hour each day or so and just pray in tongues? There is a release of wisdom that God gets us. You're praying, and I don't have time to get into a whole message explaining, you know, the power of that gift and what happens and why it happens. But basically, the Bible says when you're praying in tongues, you're speaking God's language. I'll tell you what, there's a lot of things I don't understand in the world. There's things in my life that I don't really quite understand. So I'm praying in tongues. And God brings things to your mind and to your heart. And some of you have never been prayed for the baptism of the Holy Spirit, or you have, and you've not received the gift of tongues. Now, there is an idea, and I've heard this, and I just want to say it's not true. There's an idea that God gives gifts, and if he wanted to give me the gift of tongues, he would, but I didn't get it, so he must not have wanted to give it to me. I just want to tell you, that's religion. That's a lie. That's not scriptural. You know what? Jesus died. How many believe Jesus died for everybody's sins? How many believe that Jesus wants everybody saved? How many know that not everybody will be saved? Did Jesus make provision for everybody? Did Jesus die for everybody? It's the same with the Holy Spirit. It's the same with so many of the promises of God. See, we've just created doctrines to encourage us why we're not experiencing certain promises of God. But we have to believe to receive. Now, I want to say to you, there's areas in my life that I am developing faith for it because I'm not at that place. And by no means, some people have just, you know, they say, well, you just don't have enough faith, and that's condemnation. That's just rubbish, because that's not the way that God works. We are all going to die and stand before God someday, and we're going to be like, I didn't get the fullness of everything that God had for me while I was living on earth. But the other side of that extreme is that we make excuses why it's not for me, and I'm the type of person, actually, that would rather have somebody say to me, actually, you're missing it because you're doing something wrong or believing wrong, because you know why? That's, for some people, that's like, oh, that's condemnation. For me, that's liberty, because it means I can change. It means my circumstances can change. And that's the same for all of us. And so, you know, why do some people, they get saved, and they're in drugs and alcohol and pornography, and suddenly they get saved and it's all gone. And some people, they're like, man, I've been smoking for 30 years and trying to break this thing, and I have my good moments and my bad moments. Why do some people have great faith and see healing, and other people are struggling in poverty? Why do people see their husbands saved that they've been praying for, and some people, it just seems to be year after year? Sometimes it's because we're praying wrong. Sometimes we're you know, there could be connections, there could be sin. Obviously, other people have free wills. There's a whole thing. But there's a place where all I could say is in certain areas of my life that I've worked at, that God has spoken to me and his promises in his word, when there's faith becomes present, I got it. For those who here that were part of when this church started in those early days, I was sick with an autoimmune disease for 5 years. It took me that long to work through. First, the first thing I had to do was discover, does God heal all the time? That was the first thing I had to settle. Once I went to the Word and realized it was always God's to heal, man, I had a lot of other mountains that I had to deal with. Fear in my life, unbelief in my life. I had to get the Word of God. I had to believe that it was already done. Man, there was this whole problem. It took me 5 years, and there came a day where I go, man, I'm healed. I just woke up one day and said, actually, I'm healed. There's other people who are just like, man, it's instantaneous. And other people, it doesn't happen at all. But it's not because God didn't say so. If you have been seeking the baptism of the Holy Spirit and you want the gift of tongues and you haven't seen it, my encouragement to you is that it's available for you. If somebody's told you God just didn't give it to you, or if you feel that there's something wrong with you, that's all lies. Pursue. Pursue developing the faith. One of the best scriptures in it, and I want to read you two scriptures and then we're going to pray. Luke, just to encourage you to hopefully build some faith in you before we pray. For that, and Luke chapter 11, Jesus talks about prayer, and then he talks about, he says in verse 9, so I say to you, ask and it will be given to you, seek and you will find, knock and it will be opened to you, for everyone who asks receives, and he who seeks finds, and to him who knocks it will be open. If Jesus said it, come on. Come on, church. Where's your amen? Or oh my, or whatever you, oh me. Whatever it is that you want to say. Amen. There you go. It's the Word. It's like Jesus saying to the disciples, fear not, just before he was going to the cross. Do you think Jesus just said that like, oh yeah, just don't be afraid? He meant it that it was possible. Otherwise, he wouldn't have said it. Now, we know that they feared and fled. But so often, we take the words of Jesus like as a suggestion. That's not what he's saying. He says, if you ask, you seek, you will find, you will get it. And then he says this, if a son asks for bread from any father among you, will he give him a stone? Or if he asks for a fish, will he give him a serpent instead of a fish? Or if he asks for an egg, will he offer him a scorpion? So we've already talked about the goodness of God. And for some of you, you have a hard time believing that God loves you and is good. And that's been your obstacle to be receiving from God. Okay? And so he wants you to know that he loves you. If then being evil know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? Now here's just an interesting side note. He also talks about the same thing in Matthew chapter 5, and he says, how much will the Father give good gifts to those who ask? He doesn't mention the Holy Spirit. What does that mean? I used to think, oh, that's just somebody recorded it differently. But actually, if you follow the timeline and put all the Gospels next to each other, this actually falls in a different time period. It shows that Jesus preached the same thing over and over again. Luke chapter 4, it says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he's anointed me. It says he went about to the synagogues as he usually did. So what did he do? He went around to the synagogues, opened up to Isaiah 61, said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. Why does he keep repeating himself? Because the Bible says faith comes by hearing and hearing by the Word of God. It doesn't say faith comes by I heard. Faith comes by hearing. Hearing is an active, continual process. You need to keep hearing it. You need to keep hearing that God loves you. 1 John, it talks about, in chapter 4, it talks about you need to reassure your hearts in the love of God. You need to keep telling yourself the Father loves you. You need to keep saying he's got good gifts for me. You need to keep reminding yourself that he is a good father. And if I ask for a stone, he's not going to give me bread. Because my circumstances may be crying out and saying, your circumstances may be saying, I don't have money, I'm sick. This is, you know, when the Bible's telling you something different, well, it must not work or God must not love me. And you need to get to the Word and say, this is what the Word says. This is what the Word says. This is what the Word says. I believe the Word. I believe the Word. I'm not believing the Word, but I'm going to say it. I'm saying it. I'm standing on it. And you develop faith within yourself. You're accessing the promises of God. Mark, okay, last one. Mark chapter 16. Mark chapter 16. Verse 15, and he said to them, go into all the world, preach the gospel to every creature. He who believes and is baptized will be saved, but he who does not believe will be condemned. And these signs will follow those who believe. Now, I have a margin in my Bible that quotes sometimes what's in the original language, and I've also looked at it in the original language. And actually what this says is, and these signs will follow those who have believed. Okay? In my name, they will cast out demons. They will speak with new tongues. They will take up serpents. If they drink anything deadly, it will by no means hurt them. They will lay hands on the sick, and they will recover. And so if you have come to Jesus and you have become a Christian, that's the prerequisite to being baptized with the Holy Spirit. Because you don't want to be a non-Christian and come for the baptism of a spirit, and you don't know what spirit you might get. It can be weird. And so the first thing is we come to Jesus, and we enter into relationship. And so if you don't know Jesus, then you need Jesus. I just say, God, my life has been lost without you. And through Jesus, I believe that Jesus is the Son of God. I believe that he died for my sins. I believe that he rose again. I believe that I'm surrendering my life to you. I declare that. I confess that. I invite you into my life for you to be Lord, for you to take the reins of my life, and you to begin to lead me through your love and through who you are. It's as simple as that. It's an act of surrender. And if you've never done that, then I would suggest, man, what a great opportunity, what a great day. We can't open the altar and pack people in and say, hey, if you've never done that. But you can, right where you're at, say, hey, I've done religion, but I've never met with Jesus. You can do that right now. You could do that right now. You could do that right now. And he says, this is what should happen to those who have believed. And one of those signs is that they will speak in new tongues. And I have come to believe that the gift of tongues and speaking in tongues opens up the doorway to all the other gifts. The more you pray in tongues, the more you have faith for the supernatural. The more you have faith for seeing those demons cast out. Because you're tapping into something that's of the Spirit. You're praying the Spirit. You're in in his heart and in his mind. And so this is what I want to do. If you are here and you would like to pray in tongues and you haven't, and again, you've maybe never been baptized in the Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit baptize you right now. Pray in tongues. Maybe you've been baptized in the Holy Spirit and you've seeking tongues, but you've not had it. And you would like that. What I want to do is I want to ask you in a minute to stand. And I'm going to ask that, and I'm going to pray a short prayer. And I'm going to ask everybody who does speak in tongues to just pray in tongues around you. Okay? And to exercise that gift and to pray that. To build. Actually, we're going to do that for a moment first. To build faith. And so I'm going to pray, and I'm just going to ask you to pray in tongues. I mean, this stuff is powerful. Some people would say, well, if you pray in tongues in church, should there not be an interpretation? So just in case somebody has that thought and go, is this biblical? Let me just clarify. When a group of people are praying in tongues together, praying in tongues builds you up in your most holy faith. When you're in a meeting and somebody gets up and people are praying in tongues and somebody gets up really loudly and goes, Shikoriya papa shanakoriya, you know, and they rise up above and they're obviously speaking to the group in tongues, then there needs to be an interpretation. But to just pray in tongues in a church setting, you don't have to have an interpretation given up front for what it is if we're just doing it together corporately to build ourselves up in most holy faith, okay? Does that help? We want to be biblical in what we're doing, okay? And so we're going to take a moment, we're going to pray in tongues, and then I'll give you an opportunity. I'm going to say then, if you have faith, okay? I'm not going to say that if you want to be baptized in the Holy Spirit and you've never spoken in tongues and you want it, but you don't have faith for it, then don't stand. What you need to do is meet with your pastor and say, listen, I don't have this and I want this. Could you help me walk this path to get this? Because you want to build yourself up in faith. So often we speak things out. We speak prayers out of unbelief. Man, I've spoken a lot of prayers that hit the ceiling, didn't even make it to the ceiling. You ever prayed those? Man, they're just like, it's like the paper airplane that's a dud. It just, you know? And a lot of times it's because I just prayed a bunch of fear. And so what I'm learning to do is to watch how I pray, build myself up in the Spirit, spend time in the Word, confess the Word, then when faith arises, then I pray. Mark 11:23-24, if you speak to a mountain, be removed and cast into the sea, it will. When you pray, believe that you have received. So if you have no belief in your prayer, then you're better off getting into the Word, renewing your mind. That's okay. There's no condemnation. There are lots of things in my life that I have not experienced yet that are meant for me. So I'm not condemning anybody in any way because I've got this gift and you don't, because there's a lot of areas in my life that people are operating in that I haven't. So we're on a journey together of faith, okay? So So this is a place of encouragement, but we also want to give you an opportunity. So that's why I say if you don't have faith, then talk to your pastor. Go to God, actually. Go to the Holy Spirit first. Then you come, you know, and just say, hey, or go to someone you know or to a friend and just say, hey, I really want someone to believe with me. I want you to spur me on. I really believe this gift's for me. I'm not operating in it. Give me scriptures. Let's encourage each other. Help me build my faith. And that goes for any area of your life. Let me just say one last thing, and then we're going to pray. One of the things that the church has gotten into that's connected, I think, to modern psychology, and it's just not really helpful, is sympathy. Okay? Sympathy is not a great thing. We think it's a good thing, but it's not a good thing. When I'm struggling, I don't need... Now, sometimes you need a shoulder that you can cry on or something. I'm not saying that's wrong, but we don't need a bunch of people just saying, oh, that's so sad. Oh, you're struggling. Oh, you could just cry on my shoulder. Oh, I'll cry with you. We need people to encourage each other in the faith and say, this is what the Word of God says. I'm standing with you. You're getting through this. You're going to get that breakthrough. If you didn't get it here, I'm going to believe God's got good things for you. Okay? We got to spur each other on in our most holy faith. That's why you don't forsake the gathering. To encourage each other. To build faith in one another. Okay? And so we want to build in faith. Okay? So, okay, I said a lot. All right. So I'm just going to pray, and again, we'll just take a few minutes and pray in tongues all together for those who do pray in tongues. And then if you want that and you have faith for it, then just stand, and I'm going to just pray a prayer. So just say, thank you, God, that you're here. Thank you, Holy Spirit, you're already here. You've always been here because you're in us. We bring the church with us, inside of us. We are the temples of the Holy Spirit. I thank you, God, that you are dwelling in us. So we thank you, Jesus. Just keep praying in tongues. Lord, we thank you. We're coming to you according to your word, believing your word. Your word says that as we believed, that's so we receive, that if we have believed in you, these signs will follow. And so I just pray right now for people here who are desirous of the gift of tongues in their lives, and they've not experienced at this point. Lord God, I thank you. According to your word, you said if we ask, we receive, that if we ask any good thing, you'll give the Holy Spirit to those who ask. And I thank you, God, for just faith arising in people's heart right now. If that's you this morning and you're like, I don't have the gift of tongues and I'd like that, I would just invite you to stand right now. Hallelujah. Now, the Holy Spirit works. Just keep praying in tongues, everybody. The way the Holy Spirit works is he's a gentleman. I turn on the flow and I turn off the flow. It's not that he just comes in and just suddenly. It's a choice. It's a relationship. It's a working together. So there is a level of faith where you open up your mouth and you may feel something in your belly. You may feel something on the tip of your tongue. You may feel nothing at all. But there's this utterance, this thing that comes forth. But if you have to open your mouth and allow this to kind of flow. And the enemy will tell you that's just gibberish. The enemy will like to tell you you didn't receive anything. And I'll tell you, the best thing you could do when those lies come at you, you say, okay, I'm just going to do it more then. That's what I find with the devil. You get lies in your head, then you just, I'm going to do it more. I'm going to do it more. And so just, we're going to keep praying in tongues. And I would just encourage you that just, in Jesus' name, I thank you for the baptism of the Holy Spirit in this place, the fire of God. It work in each and every person's lives. And for those who are standing right now, I just pray for the revelation of the love of the Father right now. I pray for the revelation of the love of the Father. The love of the Father casts out all fear, casts out all condemnation, casts out all shame, casts out all that stuff. And I just believe in Jesus' name, this is a good gift that the Father has made available to you. And it's actually, if you're born again, the Spirit is inside of you. Really, tongues is just opening up your mouth and allowing the baptism, as you've received it, you're allowing it to flow from your belly out through your mouth. That's just basically what you're doing. So if you've got the baptism of the Holy Spirit, receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit in Jesus' name, then it's that availability. You just got to step out. So we're going to continue to pray in tongues, and I would just encourage you to just begin to speak with us. It may sound strange, but that's why we're all praying with you. Just begin to open your mouth, and whatever's there, just let it begin to flow. If it's just a little phrase or a little syllable, you just keep praying it over and over. Just keep doing it. It develops as you practice it. It's like handwriting. It's like learning to walk. It grows as you practice it. And so don't let there be any shame or, oh, I just have this dot, 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 dot. It'll change. It'll develop into something else as you do that. So just open your mouth. In Jesus' name, we thank you, God. Sharakoriera pa pa pa, sharakoriera ti, sharakoriera pa pa pa, horiera da da, sharakaliera pa pa pa, sharakoriera pa pa pa, he sharakoriera pa pa pa, sharakiki, sharatu, sharapa pa pa, he sharakoriera ka, sharakaliera ti, sharakoriera ka, sharaka, horiera ka, sharakaliera ka, sharakoriera ka, I command the spirit of fear to be gone out of this place in Jesus' name. You have been defeated and you're underneath our feet. And I rebuke condemnation and fear in Jesus' name. And I command you off of these people in Jesus' name that there be no fear to believe that God doesn't want to give this. Any judgment, remember, judgment and condemnation is not for you. You're a believer. You're righteousness of Christ. So that's what you're operating on. Kusharapaka, sharapiko, kusharapapapa. Hiro kusharapapapa, sharakoriarapapapa. Kusharakoriarapapapa, sharakoriarapapapa. He sharakoriarapapapa, sharakoriarapapapa, sharaki. Kusharakoriarati, sharakayarati, sharaka. Horiarapapapa, sharakoriarati, sharakoriarati, sharaka. Horiarapapapa, sharakoriarapapapa. He kiki, sharakoriarapapapa. Horiarapapapa, sharakoriarapapapa. Horiera pa 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 pa, shira koriera pa pa pa, horiera pa pa pa, shira koriera pa pa pa, shira koriera pa pa pa. God, we want more. Shira koriera pa pa pa, horiera pa 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 pa, po 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 pa, po po po, shira kira koriera pa pa pa. Thank you, Jesus. We thank you, Lord God. Koriera ti shira koriera ti shira ko, horiera pa pa pa, shira koriera pa pa pa. Ishirakuriera pa pa pa, shirakuriera ti shiraku, horiera ti shirakuriera ti shirakuriera ti shirakuriera ti shiraka, horiera ti shirakuriera ti shirakuriera ti shiraka, horiera ti shirakuriera ku shirakuriera ti shiraka, horiera ti shiraku, horiera. I don't know if any of the worship team wants to come up, but Dominika, can you sing tongues with us? Is that okay? Just to sing, you know, we sing in tongues. I don't know if anybody wants to come up and just play some instrumental, but even just to have you singing it there. We can speak it, we can sing it. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Koriera pa pa pa, shara koriera ti shara ko. Koriera pa pa pa, shara koriera ti shara koriera ti shara koriera ti shara ka. Ira pa 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 pa, shara koriera ti shara koriera ti shara ka. The key is, as well as you're focusing on God, you're fixing your attention on Him. Just keep doing it. He loves you. 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 Just keep going. If you're standing, you're sitting, just keep going. Just keep going. And you're just going to go home and you're just going to keep doing it. You got to practice it. You got to keep doing it. It's a choice. It's a choice. Somebody said, am I turning on the Holy Spirit? Turning on off the Holy Spirit? Is that what you're saying? No, the Holy Spirit is always moving. Always. When we turn on, it's us turning on to what He's doing. I'm not commanding God to move. I'm joining in what He's already doing. God is moving 24 hours a day in your life. Always. But this is just tapping into it. So this is what praying in the Spirit is. If you need a miracle in your life today, I believe that there is an atmosphere for that. As we're just singing and praying in tongues, I want to encourage you, faith arises when you pray in the Spirit. We're tapping into heavenly language. And so if you have a need right now that you're like, God, I need to see, I have this need or this thing in my heart, I want to encourage you right now in this context, you bring it to Him. You're praying in tongues. There's an atmosphere here where there's faith arisen. There's a faith of yourself based on the Word, but there is a corporate anointing that also there's opportunities to just say, I'm tapping into it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You need healing. Hallelujah. There's a corporate anointing. You need provision. There's a corporate anointing. You need a job here this morning. There's a corporate anointing here for you to tap into, a flow to tap into. You have broken relationships in your family. There's an opportunity here. Loved ones who you've been praying for, there's faith here to say, I believe that by your stripes, that there's a resurrection power that you paid the price for them. The eyes of their heart open to see the revelation of God. Open to see. I believe, God, that you open their eyes, and I declare that they come to the knowledge of Jesus Christ. Do you feel you want to stand to just join in? Feel free to do that now. We're just